Now let's talk about the last part of my talk. Ramadan. This month is supposed to be about the Muslims increasing their iman. We're going to recite more Quran. We're going to come to the masjid and spend the night there. We're going to do more dhikr. We're going to make sure we give extra sadaqah, especially online. You know, we're going to watch a lot of Islamic videos. And in order to get to the masjid, we have to hurry because there's going to be a lot of traffic. And if somebody cuts you off, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, they're going to get it because they got in between you and your worship of Allah. Forget about linnas. You know, we don't even forget sparing non-Muslims. We don't even spare Muslims. We don't even spare Muslims. Allah says in the Quran about the believers' attitude towards each other, ruhama baynahum. They are loving, caring, merciful towards each other. They are merciful towards each other. You know, one of the things I notice when I come, and I don't see it as much here, even though I see some of it, I don't see it as much. When you get off the plane, when the flight lands, and the announcement is made, that you know, this little seatbelt sign goes off, ding! You know what happens next, right? Everybody gets up, seatbelts off, they're trying to get the suitcase, whatever. And I get off, and I have my children with me, and there's a man behind me, and I'm in row 36. There's no way I'm getting off the plane right now, there's a lot of people ahead of me, but there's a guy behind me, who's just, somehow if he can just get ahead. And he's in such a hurry, not because he's missing a flight, but because we don't like getting in line. And he's trying to run over my son somehow. So I just made his job easier. I moved my son, I said, go ahead, enjoy. So now instead of being in 37, he's in 34. Huge success. Because the guy in front of him was mashallah, you know, so there was no lane to cut. In small things, we don't have courtesy towards each other. Small things. Small things. How are we going to be capable of showing courtesy to humanity when you can't even show courtesy to your family member? You can't even show it to your neighbor. You can't even show it to the person who's driving next to you. You know, and I learned something about KL traffic this weekend. When you get stuck in traffic, you go like this. That's how you move. You don't move slowly. You have to go fast and stop, and fast and stop. And why do you do that? Do you like stomach aches? Is that what you... Then I realized why you do it, because if you go slowly, some other guy will do what? Some other guy is gonna cut you up. So you cannot, you have to, just in order to survive, you have to cut the other guy off. You know, if one more car gets ahead of you, you will never make it home. So... So we have to take a few steps back. This religion is beautiful. The teachings of Ibrahim alayhi salam are incredible. They are up here. But you know what? We have to start from down here. We have to start at the basics and move our way up. Before we talk about being decent Muslims, good Muslims, we have to talk about being decent human beings. We have to do that first. You know, being a decent human being means you're on the fitrah. And when you have the fitrah, then Islam and Iman, they perfect that fitrah. But if your fitrah itself is corrupt, if your fitrah itself is no good, if your courtesy towards other human beings isn't even there, there's no rahmah inside you, there's no courtesy inside you, there's no forgiveness inside you, there's a selfishness and a greed inside you, then the other higher ideals, salah, zakah, hajj, these ibadat, they're supposed to perfect that character. Then it just becomes empty. It just becomes worship for the sake of worship. You know, I'm so shocked. Sometimes I just get amazed. I was at Umrah not too long ago. And when I made Umrah, I decided to try to touch Hajar Aswad. Bad idea. As I got closer and I realized the incredible multi-wrestler event that was happening, I decided I'm not going to touch Hijr Aswad. As an act of worship to Allah, I will not touch it. As an act of worship to Allah, I won't touch it. You know why? Because in order to touch it, I will have to hurt other Muslims. I will have to hurt someone who came to worship Allah. I'll have to elbow someone in the face. knee someone, push someone. By the time I get there, I have to ask forgiveness for what I just did. So I would rather not. I would rather not do that. I would rather not cause pain to someone else. You see old ladies at the haram, old ladies that are being pushed around, and it breaks your heart. This is the people, these are the Muslims that are supposed to take care not just of other Muslims, but of all humanity. They're not even taking care of each other at the house built by Ibrahim alayhi salam. It breaks my heart. It breaks my heart. We have to go back to these fundamentals. It's otherwise this is just entirely artificial. So what if you know how to recite Quran? So what if you have great tajweed, mashallah, good for you. But that great tajweed should come with great adab, great etiquette, great courtesy for elders. You know, great love for your mother. You know, that's what you're supposed, it's supposed to come with that. We're standing there reciting that Quran, that same Quran that was given to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And by the way, don't underestimate it. Think about this. The Quran was given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at what age? At what age? 40. 40. For 40 years, Allah decided not to give him Quran. So two-thirds of his life without Quran. Only 23 years with Quran, yes? Man, we could have got all 63 years, but no. Like Isa alayhi salam got revelation when? From as a baby. He got it from the beginning. But Allah waits how many years for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? 40 years. Those 40 years are valuable. They're important. And the Quran describes those 40 years in one ayah. All those 40 years are described in one ayah. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. You are committed to a great character. In other words, the Quraysh, the disbelievers, should accept Islam, not even because of the Quran, but because they know your character. Those 40 years are 40 years of proof that you cannot be a liar. They call you Sadiq, they call you Amin. They call you truthful, they call you trustworthy. They love your courtesy, they love your respect, they love your soft tongue. They love how you never hurt anyone, they love how you're always reliable. They love these things about you. They actually are willing to listen to anything you say before you even say it. And that credibility has been established over the course of how many? 40 years. Those 40 years are important. They don't care. You don't say that the seerah begins at the age of 40. No, 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 no. That's important. And the Quran made it important. Now let me tell you this. We are so concerned about da'wah. We want to tell other people about Islam. And we want to show them that shirk is wrong. And worshipping idols is incorrect and all of it. But you know what? Shirk was going on for 40 years and Allah did reveal no Quran. Shirk was going on. But something was more important, which was the credibility of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Before he says something, his character should already show it. It should already show it. One of the earliest revelations in the Quran is إِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Now I ask myself and this entire ummah this question. If we are concerned about da'wah, should we not be concerned about credibility? If two-thirds of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is dedicated to establishing what? Credibility. Credibility. And that is the ultimate proof that the Quran is not a lie. وَمَا صَاحِبُكُمْ بِمَجْنُونَ. The one who spent his entire life with you, your companion, is not insane. His life is actually dalil of the Quran, is proof of the Quran. Then how is it that we are going to make da'wah just handing people pamphlets and debating with them about atheism? And arguing with them about Christianity and Trinity doesn't make sense and look at these idols and you're silly and your beliefs are wrong, etc., etc. We actually start our da'wah by insulting people. We start that way. How are you ever going to invite someone if you insult them? How are you going to do that? Why would people want to be even close to you? Who would want to talk to you? Do you like talking to people who argue with you? And we call it da'wah. I don't know what da'wah you've been studying. Because that ain't the da'wah of our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. That begins with character, with courtesy, with being the most decent human being. And that's the biggest lesson this ummah has to learn. You know, I was going to tell you that this is about Ramadan. I know my time's up, right? Time's up. I got to wrap it up. I know. I'll tell you this about Ramadan. Allah Azza wa Jal says, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس. هُدَى لِلنَّاسِ.
What does that mean, hudal linnas? Anybody know?
Guidance for who? Okay, so Ramadan is supposed to be about the people who fast, the people who spend time in the masjid, the people who recite the Quran. I was expecting Shahru Ramadan alladhi unzila fihi al-Quran, hudal lis-sa'imin, hudal lil-mu'mineen. No? But instead, even in Ramadan, Allah says this is guidance for who? Humanity. You and I are fasting. You and I are trying to control our nafs. You and I are trying to become better as Muslims. Yes or no? We are becoming better as Muslims so we can show guidance to who? Humanity. Don't forget, Ramadan is actually about others, not about ourselves. The worship is about you, but the model you have to display is hudal linnas wa bayyinatin minal huda wal furqan. That's for everybody else. That's what Allah did even in the ayah of Ramadan. That's what He did. We have to restore that sense of responsibility starting from now. Starting from now, inshaAllah ta'ala. So I pray that this brief reminder of how fundamental our religion, how basically is it goes back to Ibrahim alayhi salam. And when you go back to Ibrahim alayhi salam, everything becomes clear. Our vision becomes clear as Muslims. And what we're supposed to do and what we're not supposed to do. I pray that is something that deeply takes root inside my heart, inside your hearts, and the hearts of our children, and we're actually able to live up to the standards and the teachings of this beautiful, beautiful deen. Barakallahu li wa lakum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.